Listening Library presents Inheritance, or The Vault of Souls. Inheritance, Book 4, by Christopher Paolini. Read for you by Gerard Doyle. With an exclusive interview between Christopher Paolini and his editor, Michelle Fry, immediately following the program. Into the breach. The dragon Saphira roared, and the soldiers before her quailed.
With me!
Shouted Eragon. He lifted Brisinger over his head, holding it aloft for all to see. The blue sword flashed bright and iridescent, stark against the wall of black clouds building in the west.
For the Varden!
An arrow whizzed past him. He paid it no mind. The warriors gathered at the base of the slope of rubble Eragon and Saphira were standing upon answered him with a single, full-throated bellow.
The Varden!
They brandished their own weapons and charged forward, scrambling up the tumbled blocks of stone. Eragon turned his back to the men. On the other side of the mound lay a wide courtyard. 200 of the Empire's soldiers stood huddled within. Behind them rose a tall, dark keep with narrow slits for windows and several square towers, the tallest of which had a lantern shining in its upper rooms. Somewhere within the keep, Eragon knew, was Lord Bradburn, governor of Bellatona, the city the Varden had been fighting to capture for several long hours. With a cry, Eragon leaped off the rubble toward the soldiers. The men shuffled backward, although they kept their spears and pikes trained on the ragged hole Saphira had torn in the castle's outer wall. Eragon's right ankle twisted as he landed. He fell to his knee and caught himself on the ground with his sword hand. One of the soldiers seized the opportunity to dart out of formation and stab his spear at Eragon's exposed throat. Eragon parried the thrust with a flick of his wrist, swinging Brisinger faster than either a human or an elf could follow. The soldier's face grew slack with fear as he realized his mistake. He tried to flee, but before he could move more than a few inches, Eragon lunged forward and took him in the gut. With a pennant of blue and yellow flame streaming from her maw, Saphira jumped into the courtyard after Eragon. He crouched and tensed his legs as she struck the paved ground. The impact shook the entire courtyard. Many of the chips of glass that formed a large, colorful mosaic in front of the keep popped loose and flew spinning upward like coins bounced off a drum. Above, a pair of shutters banged open and closed in a window of the building. The elf Aria accompanied Saphira. Her long black hair billowed wildly around her angular face as she sprang off the pile of rubble. Lines of splattered blood striped her arms and neck. Gore smeared the blade of her sword. She alit with a soft scuff of leather against stone. Her presence heartened Eragon. There was no one else whom he would rather have fighting alongside him and Saphira. She was, he thought, the perfect shieldmate. He loosed a quick smile at her, and Aria responded in kind, her expression fierce and joyous. In battle, her reserved demeanor vanished, replaced by an openness that she rarely displayed elsewhere. Eragon ducked behind his shield as a rippling sheet of blue fire appeared between them. From beneath the rim of his helm, he watched as Saphira bathed the cowering soldiers in a torrent of flames that flowed around them, yet caused them no harm. A line of archers on the battlements of the castle keep let fly a volley of arrows at Saphira. The heat above her was so intense that a handful of the arrows burst into fire in midair and crumbled to ash, while the magical wards Eragon had placed around Saphira deflected the rest. One of the stray arrows rebounded off Eragon's shield with a hollow thud, denting it. The plume of flame suddenly enveloped three of the soldiers, killing them so quickly they did not even have time to scream. The other soldiers clustered in the center of the inferno, the blades of their spears and pikes reflecting flashes of bright blue light. Try though she might, Saphira could not so much as singe the survivors. At last, she abandoned her efforts and closed her jaws with a definitive snap. The fire's absence left the courtyard startlingly quiet. It occurred to Eragon, as it had several times before, that whoever had given the soldiers their wards must have been a skilled and powerful magician. Was it Murtagh? He wondered. If so, why aren't he and Thorn here to defend Bellatona? Doesn't Galbatorix care to keep control of his cities? Eragon ran forward and with a single stroke of Brisinga lopped off the tops of a dozen pole arms as easily as he had flicked off the seed heads of barley stalks when he was younger. He slashed the nearest soldier across the chest, slicing through his mail as if it were the flimsiest of cloth. A fountain of blood arose. Then Eragon stabbed the next soldier in line and struck the soldier to his left with his shield, knocking the man into three of his companions and bowling them over. The soldiers' reactions seemed slow and clumsy to Eragon as he danced through their ranks, cutting them down with impunity. Saphira waded into the fray to his left, batting the soldiers into the air with her enormous paws, lashing them with her spiked tail and biting and killing them with a shake of her head. While to his right, Arya was a blur of motion, every swing of her sword signalling death for another servant of the Empire. When Eragon spun around to evade a pair of spears, he saw the fur-covered elf Blodgarm close behind, as well as the 11 other elves whose task it was to guard him and Saphira. Farther back, the Varden poured into the courtyard through the gap in the castle's outer wall. But the men refrained from attacking. It was too dangerous to go anywhere near Saphira. Neither she nor Eragon nor the elves required assistance in disposing of the soldiers. The battle soon swept Eragon and Saphira apart, carrying them to opposite ends of the courtyard. Eragon was not concerned. Even without her wards, Saphira was more than capable of defeating a large group of 20 or 30 humans by herself. A spear thudded against Eragon's shield, bruising his shoulder. He whirled toward the thrower, a big, scarred man, missing his lower front teeth, and sprinted at him. The man struggled to draw a dagger from his belt. At the last moment, Eragon twisted, tensed his arms and chest, and rammed his sore shoulder into the man's sternum. The force of the impact drove the soldier backwards several yards, whereupon he collapsed, clutching at his heart. Then a hail of black-fletched arrows fell, killing or injuring many of the soldiers. Eragon shied away from the missiles and covered himself with his shield, even though he was confident his magic would protect him. It would not do to become careless. He never knew when an enemy spellcaster might fire an enchanted arrow that could breach his wards. A bitter smile twisted Eragon's lips. The archers above had realized that their only hope of victory lay in somehow killing Eragon and the elves, no matter how many of their own they had to sacrifice to do so. "You're too late," thought Eragon with grim satisfaction. "You should have left the Empire while you still had the chance." The onslaught of clattering arrows gave him the chance to rest for a moment, which he welcomed. The attack on the city had begun at daybreak, and he and Saphira had been at its forefront the whole while. Once the arrows ceased, Eragon transferred Brisinga to his left hand, picked up one of the soldiers' spears, and heaved it at the archers 40 feet above. As Eragon had discovered, spears were difficult to throw accurately without substantial practice. It did not surprise him then when he missed the man he was aiming for. But he was surprised when he missed the entire line of archers on the battlements. The spear sailed over them and shattered against the castle wall overhead. The archers laughed and jeered, making rude gestures. A swift movement at the periphery of his vision caught Eragon's attention. He looked just in time to see Arya launch her own spear at the archers. It impaled two who were standing close together. Then Arya pointed at the men with her sword and said, "Brisinger!" And the spear burst into emerald green fire. The archers shrank from the burning corpses and as one fled from the battlements, crowding through the doorways that led to the upper levels of the castle. "That's not fair," Eragon said. "I can't use that spell, not without my sword flaring up like a bonfire." Arya gazed at him with a faint hint of amusement. The fighting continued for another few minutes, whereupon the remaining soldiers either surrendered or tried to flee. Eragon allowed the five men in front of him to run away. He knew they would not get far. After a quick examination of the bodies that lay sprawled around him, to confirm that they were indeed dead, he looked back across the courtyard. Some of the Varden had opened the gates in the outer wall and were carrying a battering ram through the street leading to the castle. Others were assembled in ragged lines next to the keep door, ready to enter the castle and confront the soldiers within. Among them stood Eragon's cousin, Roran, gesturing with his ever-present hammer while he issued orders to the detachment under his command. At the far end of the courtyard, Saphira crouched over the corpses of her kills.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.